Good news from the graveyard. He's not dead. Woo-hoo-hoo. I seek he the living among the dead. There was a resurrection, just like he said.
First Corinthians chapter number 1, verse 17, for Christ sent me not to baptize, comma, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ be made of none effect. That's why we like old time preaching, not educated scholarly lectures. Right? For the preaching of the cross is them that perish what? Foolishness. It's foolish for a man to get up and declare the gospel with emphasis, with effectual power. Amen. Not with wisdom of words. Amen. A lot of people think that you're supposed to be foolish when you preach. That ain't what he said. He chose the foolishness of preaching. Right? For the preaching of the cross to them that perish is foolishness to us which are saved is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. That's when God takes away all your mind, all your facts, everything you're trusting in. God brings it to nothing. I tell you, that's a humbling spot right there to be in. That's why they don't want to hear old-fashioned preaching. Old-fashioned preaching takes you to the Word of God and leaves you without an excuse. Shows you that you're totally depraved. And except you come to Jesus Christ, there's no other way into heaven. I mean, God, old-time preaching strips you of everything that you're resting in, trusting in, believing in, hoping in. Right? Bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. I mean, these men are so wise, they're so smart, but compared to the book, they're idiots. They don't like that. They don't like it when you preach it that where a child get a hold of it, but a wise man, he just can't get down to where a child's level's at. He's above it. God brings him to nothing. Verse 20, where's the wise? Where's the scribe? Where's the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? Sure has. Amen. They think they come from a monkey. Laugh at it, mock at it, right? Makes it foolish. Stupid. Think that there's an explosion and everything got created through an explosion. Amen. Go up and blow up a Lowe's and see how many city blocks you have complete water, electricity, foundation, house, all completely built through an explosion. It's impossible. Amen. Verse 21. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. You want to find the surest way to lose salvation and lose the sight of God? Go to college. Right? The only way you'll find God in the average college, you got a Christian who's going to witness to you against a curriculum that you're being taught. It's got to be somebody outside the curriculum, because the curriculum's designed and the professors are designed to educate you out of God, not encourage you to find God. Even courses on religion don't lead you to Jesus unless you got a Christian teaching the courses and defining the difference between religions and Christianity and gives you an option to be saved. Amen. Usually they'll talk about Calvary. They don't put any conviction on it. Listen, a preacher can teach on hell and never make you feel the heat until he applies it. Preaching applies the truths of the Bible. Right? Verse 21, after that in wisdom of God, the world by wisdom, knew not God, for it pleased God by you acting like an idiot when you preach to save them that believe. That ain't what it says, is it? It said it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. I'm talking about a man that feels what he preaches. You understand? When you got heartfelt preaching, a man's been saved, touched by God, feels and believes what he's preaching, preaches with full heart and love for Jesus Christ and a hatred for sin and the devil, listen, they'll think you're an idiot. Got to preach with conviction. You also got to preach with compassion. You got to preach with charity. But you better know, you better be preaching Christ and Him alone for salvation.
Amen.
For to the Jews requires sign, and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. Unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them that are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Hey, amen. Romans chapter number 10. Romans chapter number 10. Verse 1, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that he might be saved. Here's a religion that supposedly knows the true and living God, the Creator God. And Paul's praying they'd get saved, so their religion couldn't save him, could he? Just a belief in God. Jesus said in John 14:1, you believe in God, believe also me. Listen, I was talking to Coach Dwayne the other day about devils. And devils will come up to Jesus Christ and say, thou art the Son of the living God. They believe Jesus is the Son of God. They know it, upon shadow of a doubt. But are they saved? They're not saved because they never placed their faith in Jesus Christ to save them. In fact, Christ didn't die to save angels or devils. He died for man. Right? But notice what it says in verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, shall believe where? In thine heart, God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart, man believeth what? Unto righteousness, with the mouth, confession made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there's no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich on all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's not just saying a prayer. That's crying out from the heart. You realize you're a lost sinner and need to trust the finished work of Jesus Christ and His shed blood to save you. So where do you come up with that? Read the rest of the book of Romans. We're trying to get a lot of people to 1, 2, 3, repeat after me in verse 13, and ain't getting them saved. Because they're not applying their heart to the finished work of Jesus Christ. You got to have the gospel. The gospel's not really, I mean, it's partially mentioned there. And it's not just to believe enough to believe in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. I was reading a guy, he fell out with Ruckman and Donovan over the shed blood and said they don't believe in the shed blood of Jesus Christ to save them. And his dad wrote a tract about the bloodless gospel. But it's not enough just to believe in the shed blood. You say, how do you know that? Well, I'm going to put my faith in Calvary and the blood atonement. That's good, but it ain't enough to save you. You say, what are you talking about? Look at what he says in verse 9, that if thou shalt confess in the mouth of the Lord Jesus and believe in the heart that God what? Raise him from the dead. You don't believe in the resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you can forget it. How did Christ die for our sins? Was buried and then rose again the third day. If he didn't get up out of the grave, I don't care how much you believe in the blood atonement, how much blood he spilled. If you don't believe he got up to save you, amen, you can't get it. You better have all the elements. Death, burial, resurrection, for our sins. That's the gospel. Right? Sadducee called on God all he wanted and never get saved. Why? Because he didn't believe in the resurrection. Yeah. Unless he believed in the resurrection, he couldn't get saved. Well, I just believe he just trusted the blood. If he didn't believe God raised from the dead, he can't get saved. According to the passage. Read the passage. Right? Yeah. Verse 14. How shall they call upon him if they've not believed? How shall they believe in him whom they've not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher? How shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace. Bring glad tidings of good things. There's the good news. But they have not all obeyed what?
The gospel.
You better preach the full gospel, not charismatic full gospel. But the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ with his full blood atonement, with his resurrection, amen, with his sinless life. Right? You better preach it complete. But you know what you got to do? You don't obey the commandments, you obey the gospel. Romans 6:17 says you've obeyed from the heart. Right? Verses saith, Lord, who hath believed? If you put your faith in the gospel, that's obeying the gospel. It's not getting wet in the water. Right? So then, faith cometh by hearing, comma, and hearing by the word of God. How shall they hear without a preacher? Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the... It's up to you to open your mouth, tell somebody about Jesus. It's not enough just for you to quote three verses. You better pray God give you some time. We got hyper soul winners running from door to door to door just giving somebody about three or four verses. Say this prayer and you're going to get saved. You better be careful. Amen. You better give them the full story of Jesus Christ. That takes time. You know, we ain't got time. We ain't got time. You better be careful. Amen. They better know why he died. Verse 3. Look at verse 3. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness. You know what they are? They're ignorant. They don't know. They believe they know. They think they're doing as best as they know how to do, but they're not saved. Hello? They're ignorant of God's righteousness. You know what you got to do? I think the book of Romans is all designed to show you God's righteousness versus man's righteousness. They must know their righteousness is going to damn their soul to hell. They must know that God's righteousness is imputed to them through the finished work of Jesus Christ, which includes the resurrection. That if they'll trust what Christ did for them, they'll receive Christ's atonement. Right. They'll receive His righteousness. And God, listen, you got to go through and understand. You got to have some time to talk to some people. Preach. We find one little verse. Have some little person just say a prayer. A lot of people's prayed prayers. Muslims pray prayers. Catholics pray prayers. More than half the world's religion today is praying prayers. But they're not going to heaven. They must know. Preaching must be heard. Amen? They're ignorant of God's righteousness, going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves on the righteousness of God. You must submit yourself to the righteousness of God. You must present yourself a sinner before God. God, I'm an unworthy sinner. God, I'm going to hell. I don't want to go. It's been revealed to me today through the Scriptures and through the Word of God that I'm lost and undone. I don't want to go to hell. Got to be crying from the heart. Right? If they don't see that, how are they going to get in? It takes time to deal with a sinner. It takes time to bring forth a baby. A young couple gets married. They don't go to the baby's room the next day and expect to coddle a baby. It takes time. Right? It takes preparation to grow a baby. It takes time to birth a sinner. We ain't got time. We gotta hurry up. Just call upon the name of the Lord. Will you? You better be careful. A lot of people praying prayers, you don't get them into heaven. Right? I know a guy, he shows one verse. He's out on the streets, one verse. Who's ever not written book of life is cast in the lake of fire. You just call upon the Lord right now, He'll save you from the lake of fire. Just pray. That's a good verse. But you better be careful. What are they trusted? Right. Ephesians chapter 1. You first trusted Christ. You got to place your heart in what Christ did. You don't know what Christ did. How can you trust Him? You got to hear the gospel, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 12 to 14. You got to trust Christ. You got to trust what He did in the gospel. How should they hear? Preaching. Amen. I like preaching. Preaching must be heard. You got to hear. So, well, how can a deaf man hear? God's got a way of making a deaf man hear. The Scriptures preach. If he can read, right? He can get saved. He said, I don't believe you can get saved reading the Bible. The Scripture preached to Pharaoh. You better, this book's alive. It's quick and powerful. It's the incorruptible seed. It's what does the job. Amen? I understand we're supposed to preach the book and God activates something through the preached word and He works on somebody through the Holy Ghost with the words that are preached. I understand that. Men put too much prize on the anointing of the minister more than they do the anointing of the Word of God and the power of the Word of God, which is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It'll cut. It'll get where it needs to go. It's like a hammer to break that rock. It's like a fire to burn. It won't come back void. Isaiah 55. It'll accomplish what God wants accomplished. We just put too much emphasis on a messenger more than we put an emphasis on the Word of God. The Holy Ghost takes the Word of God and applies it. It's not how much a man sweats or spits. Amen? It's how much the Holy Ghost wants to make a sinner squirm. I can't make a sinner squirm no matter what I say. But this book can. This book can hang a man out over hell. The preacher don't hang a man out over hell and make him fear. It's the Holy Ghost of God that does that. And I don't believe it's so much what the preacher does as how much the saints pray. Hello? Yeah. God's more interested in a sinner getting saved than we are. Right? Yes. God needs to make a sinner curious. Amen. God needs to make a sinner convicted. Hello? Amen. Preaching must be heard. Number one, 1 Timothy chapter 1. If you go to 1 Corinthians 14 in the tongues chapter, you'll see how the process works. The man hears, he gets convicted. He humbles himself, kneels down, he gets converted. You understand? 1 Timothy chapter number 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope. Number one, you know what preaching does? It brings hope. Amen. Now what's that matter? What's the big deal about it bringing hope? Well, they don't have a hope. They don't know what tomorrow holds. They don't know what their future is. The whole world thinks they ought to come to America and build a nice house and get a good job and drive a nice car and have a pretty woman. Hello? And they think all that's what's going to make the difference. There ain't no hope when your family's laying in a hospital bed. There ain't no hope when your family's dying of cancer. There ain't no hope when they got a brain tumor. There ain't no hope when he has a heart attack and dies and the breadwinner's cut off. Listen, where's hope after you go to the cemetery? What's tomorrow? They say, well, we're all reincarnated. Good night. Come back as a dragonfly. Oh, that's great. That's a lot of hope, huh? No. Huh? Be my luck, I'd be come back as an antelope and get ate by a lion. Amen. Right? How would you like to be a water buffalo getting ate by a crocodile sipping water? Listen, I don't want to come back as an animal. Amen. The only thing that gives me any hope is the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a blessed hope. He's going to come back and take His children out of this sin-cursed world. That's good news to me. There's a purifying hope. Amen. He purifieth them, even His pure Lord. Lord, work out all the junk out of my heart. My heart's got a bunch of junk in it. Purifying hope. The Bible said in 1 Peter, there's a lively hope. Right? Christ is my hope. I don't have nothing outside of that. If He ain't who He says He is, and He ain't going to do what He said He's going to do, the Bible said in 1 Corinthians 15 over there, we're of all men most miserable. Right? But I tell you what, Brother Nick, living a Christian life, going to church, being around Christians, best life I've ever had. I've been hurt and wounded by Christians. I've been hurt and wounded by preachers. It's still the best life I've ever lived. Amen? Good, clean living. Good, clean life. Nothing wrong with it. But you know what? I got hope beyond the grave. He's coming up. I got hope that the graveyard's not the end of it. I got a hope that I'm going to see those that place their faith in Jesus Christ also. Listen, I don't have a hope that I'm going to see a lost loved one. They're going to be at the judgment. They're going to be burning. They're going to wind up being cast in a lake of fire forever. That's not a blessed hope. But I got a hope for everybody that I know that's a family member of mine or a co-worker or a child or somebody else that's a relative or a friend or a neighbor, that if they've placed their faith in Christ, we'll get to enjoy Jesus forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Listen, I sit around fellowship with Coach Dwayne. I sit around fellowship with Brother Doug Parks. I mean, the heartaches and pains those men have experienced in their life, we got a hope. And we talk about the millennium. We talk about the things we get to do in the kingdom of heaven versus spend an eternity in New Jerusalem. A lot of people talk about New Jerusalem. They talk about going to heaven where pearly gates at, and they miss over the millennial reign of Christ. I think it'd be fun to just be in the millennium and eat the fruit and food and see the animals and see the curse of God removed off the land and a lion and a lamb laying down together. Hello? That's going to be beautiful, ain't it?
Yeah.
Ephesians chapter 2, huh?
It's going to be interesting, no doubt.
Oh, it's going to be great. See Jesus sitting on a throne? Huh? Seeing all his people down through the ages, running cities. Hey, I tell you what, it's going to be something. It'd be funny to see Dr. Ruppman and John O'Reilly just having a conversation. Being civil with one another.
I'll take a picture.
Yeah, that'd be good, won't it? Ephesians 2:12. That at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope. Without God in this world, people don't have hope. Jesus Christ brings hope. You get hope through preached word of God, through witnessing and telling others and testifying of the grace of God, Acts chapter 20. A lot of people don't want to testify. Repentance toward God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Without hope. The Bible says that he would not have a sorrow as others would have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even them which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. That's a hope. That's a hope. That's a hope. Amen. That their body is going to get up out of the grave. People that we loved and we cared about is going to get up out of the grave. They're coming up. Boy, what a great thing. What a hope. Right? Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7. I'm loving what the book says about a hope. I got a hope. The Bible said in Hebrews 6, we have an anchor, the soul is a hope. That's Jesus. He says in verse 19, the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God. You know what? I got a better hope. The law couldn't make nothing perfect. Couldn't make me complete. Couldn't make me whole. The law, if there had been a law which could have gave righteousness, barely righteousness come by the law. Law can't do it. Amen. Well, you know, Psalm 19, law of the Lord is perfect, converting soul. Yeah, God will use the word of God to show you you can't keep it, can't leave it. And then he'll show you that if you trust Jesus Christ, you got a better hope than the law. That's Amen. Free grace given to you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Number two. You know, preaching does, it brings hope. Yeah, it makes you feel your pain. You know, I wouldn't give you an ounce for preacher that didn't make you feel your sin. And you see yourself a lost, dirty sinner. Listen, it brings hope. So not for them that their parents already died and went to hell. Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry about that. But I'm talking about hope for an individual if he'll place his faith in Jesus Christ. You know what preaching does? Brings help. Boy, I tell you, I needed help. My life was a mess. And the Lord Jesus Christ, I cried out to him one day in faith, fixing to be 37 years ago. I ain't never been the same. I got help. My soul got help. You know what I do? I read through the Bible every day and I get help from the Scriptures. I get help from answered prayers. I get help from Christians. I get help in my soul. Well, I wish I could find that in the book of Psalms. I don't know if I can find it. Something in the Psalms. I don't know if I can find it. It's just something I read the other day. I'm just reading so much through it, I can't pen it all down.
What is it?
It's talking about hope. And getting help, I mean. I'm sorry. It's talking about getting help, man. My soul needs help. Amen. Maybe it's 138. Let me look at 138. Psalm 138. This will work. This may not be what I was looking for. Psalm 138, verse 1. I'll praise thee with my whole heart. Hey, man, you ever praise God with everything you got in you? Did you ever let out a roar as a Christian and just from the depths of your belly? just cried out to God and blessed Him. Before the gods will I sing praise unto Thee. I will worship toward Thy holy temple and praise Thy name for Thy righteousness and for Thy truth. For Thou hast magnified Thy word above all Thy name. In the day when I cried, Thou answered me and strengthened me with strength in my soul.
Mm. That was in Psalm 119, verse...
No, it wasn't it.
137, verse 9.
I don't know what it is. I ain't got time to look for it while we're on this.
119 says, let me not be ashamed of my hope.
No, it was something else. It was it's back earlier. I'll have to find it later. Okay. Amen. And let's look at Psalm 118. But there was something else that I was looking at. Amen. Lord, have to let me stumble upon it. Psalm 118, verse 13. Thou hast thrust sore at me that I might fail or fall. But the Lord what? Help me. Psalm 28. Well, there's so much I've read through here, it's just hard to keep up with 100 Psalms in your eyes, your mind, right? Psalm 28, verse 7. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in Him and I am help. Psalm 28, verse 7. Look at 27, verse 9. Hide not Thy face far away from me. Put not Thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Look at verse 8. When Thou saidest, seek my face, my heart said unto Thee, Thy face will I seek. Amen. Look at this. Verse 13. I had fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. You know what that is? That's hope. There's help. Amen. Well, I'll tell you what. Psalm 31, verse 24. Be of good cheer, or be of good courage, and He shall strengthen your heart, all ye that what? Hope in God. Listen, there's hope, there's help. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm just glad there's times when I've needed something from God. A preacher would get up and preach and not know my situation, and he'd bring the mail, man, and he'd peel my onion and get down where I live, and then God would provide me an opportunity to get repentance. One preacher was preaching one day, I was doubting my salvation real bad and had a bunch of issues, and somebody said, well, if you doubted, you're not saved. And I said, you're an idiot, whoever says that, and I don't care if he's the greatest preacher in the world. And one preacher got up and he preached the difference between conviction and condemnation. And he talked about, he said, condemnation leaves you no hope, no room to get right. He said, conviction always points you to Calvary and always points you to God, and there's a way out and there's hope and you can get right. Condemnation never does it. You want to hear a great message, Sam Gipp just put it out on the radio, Intercessory Prayer. He shows you the difference between conviction and intimidation. A lot of preaching is intimidation versus conviction. He said, when you hit the altar, you go down to the altar to appease the man of God, or you go to the altar to get right with God. You don't read your Bible enough. You don't pray enough. You don't do this enough. You don't pass out enough track. He said, that's intimidation preaching. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. So, you know what else it does? This is a good one. Pentecost will like this one if he's hung on long enough. Brings health. You know what the Bible do? It'll heal you. Amen. It'll heal your soul. You know what he said in 3 John over there? I think it's verse 2. He talks about that thy soul prosper. Brother Dennis Hicks preached on soul health. How's your soul today? That's the real you. How's your soul? Do you feed it? Do you give it milk? Do you give it bread? Do you give it the meat of the Word of God? Do you feed it the apples of the Bible? Do you get nourishment? Do you get the honey? Woo! And the honeycomb? His words. Amen. Sometimes it's sweet to the taste and bitter to the belly. Happened to Ezekiel, happened to John. Listen, I'm trying to help you today. You know what preaching? It must be heard. It brings hope. It brings help. It brings health. Proverbs chapter number 12. Proverbs chapter number 12. Right? Talks about all thy ways, acknowledge him in chapter 3. To be health to thy navel. Ooh, yeah, I like that. I need a good, solid, healthy belly button, don't you? Right? The Bible said a virtuous woman, the crown of her husband, she that maketh ashamed is rottenness in his bones. Listen, a bad woman will give you cancer. Hello? Amen. Rottenness in the bones. Proverbs chapter number 12. Verse 4, a virtuous woman is crowned her husband. She that maketh ashamed is rottenness in his bones. Let's look at verse 18. There is it speaketh like the piercing of a sword. Conviction, pricks. But the tongue of the wise is what?
Health.
Amen. You get a wise man preaching this book, man, it'll be health. It'll help you spiritually. Right? Life of the flesh is in the blood. Amen. There's some things about diet in the Bible. Amen. Bodily exercise profit a little, but godliness profiteth what? With all. Right? Let's look in Proverbs chapter 13. Proverbs chapter number 13. Verse 17. A wicked messenger falleth into mischief, but a faithful ambassador is health. Are you an ambassador for Jesus Christ? Are you faithful? Boy, you preach the gospel of the good news. As cold waters to a thirsty soul, so is good news from a far country. You know what? That cool water, man, that's healthy. Just get a cool drink out of the Word of God. Huh? We just go down here, Brother Gabbard, next week in this old, weary, rotten, dry land and just have an opportunity to hear the man of God preach. Just get some cool waters to our thirsty souls. Man, what a blessing, huh?
Amen.
Amen. What about Luke chapter number 4? I heard this the other day. I clicked on to hear something by Gail Riplinger about the Bible. She's giving her testimony, saying some things. I really got blessed by hearing some of her testimony. How she got saved, how she helped people. Very good. How God blessed her. She went to Kent State University, and the main reason she went was to be a witness and a testimony to lead people to Jesus. And then she got all these degrees. She said God kept adding all this stuff to her. She was seeking just to go be a witness to all them young girls and people out there. She just wanted to witness for Jesus. She brought this out about the NIV and all that. Don't have this in there. Luke 4:17. And there's delivered on him a book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found a place, amen, where it is written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, and has sent me to heal the what? The brokenhearted. The NIV don't have the brokenhearted in there. It don't heal a broken heart. You can't get your heart healed from an NIV because Jesus can't heal it in the NIV. You know what people have tonight? They have broken hearts. You know what, Jesus? That'll bring health to you. Right? Hope deferred maketh the heart sick. Amen? A merry heart doeth good like a
medicine.
Listen, that book will do it. Get you right with God. Get your sins confessed up. Amen? Be at peace with God. Listen, that'll bring health. It'll remove all the stress. You know where most people are found? There's three types of people that are found that came to David. Those that were in debt.
Distressed.
You know what people are out there? They're distressed over their bills, over their home, over their relationships. They're full of distress. Get right with God, it removes the stress. They bring health. Health. And discontented, right? Well, I'll tell you what. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. Listen, it'll bring health. Contentment will bring health.
Yay.
Right? Better is a dry morsel and quietness therewith than a house full of sacrifice and strife. Boy, I tell you, health. It'll bring health. Amen. I got one on Proverbs 16. Let's see what it says. I didn't get to read it. I had it wrote down in the wrong spot. Proverbs 16. It says 26. Proverbs 16:26. He that laboreth for himself, for his mouth craveth it of him. I don't think that was what I wanted. But that'll work. Hello? Look at 24. He said, pleasant words are as a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and health to the bones. That's probably what I wanted. Right? Amen? Words of God. Preached words. Be health. Boy, I tell you what, man. Woo! Amen. Nothing like hearing that God loves you.
Amen.
Isn't that sweet?
Yeah.
I'd rather know that God loved me.
Yeah.
Huh? Mother and father, amen. Forsake me, the Lord take me up. Amen. You know what it'll do? It'll heal your heart. You need to bring your heart to Him. With the heart, man believeth on the righteousness. He'll heal a broken hearted. Over there, we just already covered it. Right? He says, you obeyed from the heart. Romans 6, 17. You call with your heart. Let's look in Hebrews 13. Now, what men do is they'll see a truth in the Bible, and so they throw the baby out with the bathwater. Okay? You understand? It's either all or nothing, but they don't have no common sense. Look at verse 9. Be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines. This is not sound doctrine, it's strange doctrines. You understand? Men want to sit back and say, be not carried about with sound doctrines, what they're trying to teach you today. For it is a good thing that the heart be established how? With grace, not with meats, which is not profitable them, they've been occupied there. So there's men that's trying to tell you, don't study the Bible, don't get the meat of the Word of God, because you know what? That's not how the heart is established. You're right. You don't establish a brand new soul and a Christian with sound doctrine as far as when it comes to deep things of the Word of God. Bring the milk to them, tell them about Jesus Christ, get them saved, get them established as a baby Christian, and eventually wean them off the milk. Who shall we make no doctrine, Isaiah 28? Them that are weaned. You understand? There's not wrong with knowing sound doctrine. There's nothing wrong with occupying yourself in strong meat. It's who you teach the meat to. There's different levels. Grow them up. It's desire to sincere milk of the Word that you may grow thereby. Then when they're weaned, give them the milk. Learn the sound doctrine. Learn it. We're not talking about strange doctrines. Well, you know, some of the things Dr. Ruckman teaches are strange. You know why it's strange? Because your mind hasn't traveled that road. And he's thought about things. He's studied that book. He's taught things. And his mind would travel. He'd ask questions. And then he'd start building things on those questions. What was the fruit that Adam and Eve ate? The world says they ate an apple. How do you know? Hello? Right? So he studies it, asks God questions about it, comes up with a doctrine on it, throws it in out there as something as food of thought for men that are studying the Word of God.
Yeah.
And then those guys take off and they run to churches and they want to cram that doctrine down people's throats. Listen, you got to be careful. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with examining, asking questions when you read the book and see what God's trying to tell you. There's some great things to come out of the Word of God. But you got to be careful who you're preaching and teaching to.
Right.
Now, I can't help it if baby Christians come in and I'm feeding the saints. You understand? Listen, like Doc Ruckman's Bible Institute, they had first year, second year, and third year students. I don't know if they rotated them all, or they just rotated a class, and third years was with 1 year, and 1 year with 3 years. I got no idea how they did that. But sometimes you got guys coming in, they're getting the fresh meat just like anybody else. And when I entered charity, Brother Eastep's teaching Ezekiel. I'm going, I had no idea what he was doing with Ezekiel. Yeah. I didn't get all the groundwork until I got other classes. You understand? I got a D in my Ezekiel 2, man. That's where I started at. I got a D. I said, oh, man, this Bible Institute's tough. But then when I started getting the groundwork, I began to understand. And then I could go back into Ezekiel 2 now, and I'd probably get an A in it. You say, why? Because I got an understanding. I got a foundation. I was trying to learn something I had no foundation for. It was in over my head, but I showed up to take the Bible. First class I was taking up there was Hosea. And it was some guy, he passed out notes, and he's just reading his notes, you know. But I didn't know where I was at. Then you take Lamentations. I'm out in left field. They're trying to teach all the way through the whole Bible, so I'm getting it. But then at home, I got the core classes. And at home, I took the core classes. There's 26 core classes you had to have to graduate. And I took them core classes. And I went, I grew. I got an understanding of the Bible. And man, when I learned that, I sat through all that, I said, whoa, me. my eyes opened up. When I hit Matthew 2, everything changed. I went through right divide, then I hit Acts 1, Acts 2, then I hit Hebrews, and then I hit Romans, and I took theology, and then I had, well, I'll tell you what, and all of a sudden my life changed. I was different, the core classes. But I was trying to take all those classes. I didn't know where I was at until I got a foundation. When I went through rightly dividing, man, things helped. He helped me. Listen, there's an order. There's a progression. But I jumped in right in the middle. I didn't know where I was at. I jumped off at the deep end of the pool. Man, I had to learn how to swim first. Yeah. Right? But, you know, it's your heart. Let's go to Luke 15. Preaching must be heard.
Amen.
You know what it does? It brings happiness. Luke chapter number 15 says there's joy in the presence of what? Verse 7. I say unto you, likewise, joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that what? You know what? There's joy in heaven over a sinner repenting. There's joy in that sinner's heart after it's been broken, after he cried, after he was contrite, the heavy burden was lifted, the peace comes in, and then he gets joy. And the more he knows that his sin is forgiven, the more he knows about the Bible, the more about Jesus, the more happier he gets. It brings happiness, not only here to the heart of a sinner, it brings happiness to those that brought the sinner that was lost and undone, and they get born again. Listen, if Nick brings in a sinner, if you guys bring in a couple co-workers and they hit the altar and they come down and get saved, you know what? They're going to be rejoicing, man. Amen. Listen, when Vicky brought her mama and she got saved, Vicky threw the songbook up in the air and hit the ceiling. She shouted, she went, woo! Hits the ceiling tile, the songbook hits the ground. People are freaking out. Vicky's just a crying, bawling.
I have to get the DVD
when I rejoice. Listen, she had a time. Right? Listen, we enjoy. We get happy. Get excited over sinners. You say, look at verse 10. One of the most misquoted verses in all the Bible. Preachers quote this all the time and they misquote it. Likewise, I say unto them, or I'm sorry, likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Where's the angels?
In God's presence.
In God's presence. Who's the one shouting?
God.
God's going, hey, somebody believe my son. Somebody put their faith in my son. Hallelujah. Amen. I think God's rejoicing.
Yeah.
Over one sinner repenteth. The angels of God are around the throne, and God's on the throne, and the Son at His right hand. And when somebody places their faith in Him, I believe He's going, hallelujah! Somebody believe me.
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
Amen. I believe there's rejoicing. What about that great cloud of witnesses in Hebrews chapter 12? And all those people, maybe it's up on the screen when they see a sinner get saved, and there's cheers in the presence of God over a sinner getting saved.
Yeah.
I ought to be shouting in the church. I ought to be shouting,
amen,
amen, from the housetops. Glory to God, I'm born again.
Amen.
I ought to touch our hearts. I ought to touch. Listen,
amen.
I want to hide it under a bushel.
No.
I pray your bushel catches on fire.
Amen.
Hide it under the bed. I want to let Satan blow. No, I'm going to let it shine. Yeah. Listen, brings happiness. Amen. When Christ is received.
Yay.
You know what preaching does? It hurts. It hurts a man's pride. Doesn't it?
Yeah.
Preaching will cut. It'll get in and tell you what you don't want to do. You know what? This book's like a mirror. You go to a doctor. You say you're going to die. You got 3 months to live. You know what? That hurts.
Yeah.
I've sat in cars with people weeping and crying because they got diagnosed with cancer. That's a sad thing.
Mm-hmm.
It hurts. Listen, sometimes preaching has to hurt you to help you.
Amen.
It hurts man's pride.
Sure does.
Amen. You know what preaching does? It harms. See, preacher, that's why I hate preaching. It harms. Hello? Amen. It harms the devil. You know what one of my greatest prayers is? I don't get to pray. God doesn't answer it very much. I say, God, help us to be able to win some of Satan's generals and place them into thy army, that they may be raised up to be a general in your army. Amen. Listen, I want to harm the devil's work. Oh, I want to hurt his work. I want to be a thorn in his side instead of him being one in mine.
Amen.
Ruckman tells all students, he said, whatever town you go in, stir it up. I haven't stirred nothing up yet. I need to kick the beehive. And he said, stir it up. Tear your town up. He said, bad publicity is good publicity. Amen. Hello? Listen, we need to harm the world. We need to harm the devil. Listen, sinners think we're harmful when we're spreading out the good news. We need to wound their conscience, don't we? We need to get in their head, don't we? I'm preaching these to get in their head. I'd like to be in their head. I'd like it to be preaching. Every time they turn around, some guy goes to reach for a beer. No. Hello? Amen. I used to light up a cigarette and someone would say, you're going to hell. Going to hell. Going to hell. What was that? It was conviction. Amen. I like to harm God's enemies. Amen. You know what preaching does? Amen. It'll take men to heaven. Men go to heaven through preaching. Right? If they accept the gospel, if they receive Christ, right? If they receive Christ, they'll go to heaven. But if they reject Christ, they'll go to hell. You know what old time sound preaching does? It brings hell to light. You know what men don't want to do? They don't want to hear about hell. They don't want to hear that they're worthy of hell. They don't want to hear they're going to hell. They don't even want to talk about hell unless they're cussing. Think they're cute. Oh, it brings hell to light. Old time preaching brings it to light that you're going there and you will spend eternity there and you will live there forever, and we don't want you to go. God doesn't want you to go. God wants nobody in hell. It was created for Satan and his angels. It wasn't created for Adam and his sons.
Right.
God don't want nobody to go to hell. God sent his son to be your substitute for it, to keep you out of hell. You know what preaching does? It brings hell to light. You know what preachers won't do today? They won't preach on hell.
Right. Amen.
They're afraid to lose a congregation. Well, then go win another one.
Amen.
How do we let people go to hell? Gently and kindly? Neglect? We won't preach on it because we're going to offend them? Or do we need to let them go to hell knowing that there was an escape and they don't have to go? And if they could trust the shed blood of Jesus Christ, he'd wash away all their sins. Listen, their religion's taking them to hell. They need to know that. Every time a Catholic goes and takes the Mass, he needs to know that it's a false Christ, a false God, and that cannot take away his sins.
Right.
You got to know that. If you partake of that, you're going to go to hell. You know how Doug Parks got saved? He's working in a foundry, and they're pouring molten steel. And they got these big old giant huge buckets of steel, and they're pouring that molten steel out. And he's watching this liquid steel roll out into these forms where they're making steel. And a Pentecostal come up to him, and he said, hey, Doug. He said, you see that? He said, yeah, I see that. He said, if you die without Jesus Christ, you're going to be right in the hellfire just like that. You'll be in something like that, burning forever, and never be able to get out. You know what Doug Parks had? He had a visual. A molten steel right there in front of him. He had a clear picture. I mean, a wise man walked up to him and said, hey, that's where you're going to live forever, bud. You know what they need to do? They need to know that. When they go to sleep, they need to see that. Hello? Amen. We watched Raiders of the Lost Ark or something like that. Something like the Indiana Jones thing. And that somebody opens up the ark. Do you ever see that?
Yeah, I see
that. When they open up the ark, and that fire comes in, and that fire hits that man's face, and his face literally melts off his body, and then his... I mean, I'm telling you what, you talk about a picture of hell, man.
Yeah.
You see that, man? I mean, this fire comes around, the wrath of God hits the guy, and his face just melts in the flames. Boy, you talk about a visual. You talk about a mouth that, wow. Put that on video, man. a guy's face melt. Would that be something, me preaching on hell, and then you just replay that thing every 8 seconds? In their whole video, somebody gets it, no matter where they go, the guy's face is melting. Huh? That'd be a video, wouldn't it? Huh? I mean, we seen a commercial last night. We were watching a little football game, and we seen a commercial last night. They're showing all these demons and all this junk coming out of hell. Well, how about if we show what a man looks like when he goes to hell? Hello? Yeah. Amen. This world's in love with a whore flick. How about coming and watching a whore flick of a bunch of people burning in hell? And say, that's where you're going, pal. Not being happy, not being... I mean, listen, go open an Iron Maiden video or a record album, amen, and they got Eddie standing there with his hand out like this. He's a scald individual. Right? And then they got a picture of hell, and in there they got all these little demons in hell and all these little devils sticking souls and burning them with pitchforks. And then you open up the album, they got the rock and roll singers there of Iron Maiden sitting there in hell, and they were told that they'll get to be rulers in hell. That's why they're not burning. But everybody else is burning. But they're singing songs about 666 and serving Satan. And they're showing people being tormented and being stuck with pitchforks. Mocking the inhabitants that they're all going to go to hell. You know what? It brings hell to light. You know what people don't want to hear? They don't want to hear hell, fire, and damnation. I'll never forget Gary Luchert coming up to me in Arkansas. And he's saying, son, I ain't heard nobody preach on hell at a camp meeting in a long time. They don't believe you ought to preach on hell on camp meetings. Why not? We went to youth camps. I'd preach on hell. Hello? People are going to hell. They said he went in Billy Sunday's room one day and he's kneeling in front of a window where he's preaching revival, and he's kneeling in front of a window, and the person walked in and they heard Billy praying, God, they're going to hell. They're going to hell. God, they're going to hell. God, they're going to hell. God, they're going to hell. Boy, you know what preaching does? It brings hell to light. Puts a lot of light on them. You know what it does? This is probably more hated than that. What I'm fixing to bring right here. What I'm fixing to write right here is why they don't want to hear old time preaching. Holiness.
Amen.
People don't want to be holy. They want to be fleshly. They want to be carnal. You know, they want to be sensual. Since when is God's people supposed to be sensual? When are God's people supposed to be sexy? Huh? Yeah, amen. Hello? Holiness. Pentecostals used to be your old-time holiness people. Now they're anything but. They're anything goes. Yep. To their philosophy is, you got it, flaunt it. Hello? No. I don't believe in flaunting it. I believe in wrapping it up, covering it up. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know what preaching is? It's hated.
Amen.
It's hated by the world. It's hated by the flesh. It's hated by the devil. The Bible says over there in 2 Corinthians, I didn't bring this out, 2 Corinthians chapter 7. I think the Lord wanted me to bring that back out. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 said, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. You know what he said? He said, cleanse us. Let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit. There's people got dirty spirits. You know what the Bible calls a dirty spirit? Unclean spirit. A lot of people got unclean spirit. They're dirty. You know what they got? They got a dirty spirit and they got dirty flesh. Perfecting holiness? How? In the fear of God. Didn't say perfecting holiness through the love of God. It said through the fear of God. You know what I fear? I fear not being holy. You know what people say? You know what a lot of preachers do? You're so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. I just got to be able to fit in, you know. Everybody think I'm a kook, I'm a freak. A Muslim don't care if you're wearing a burqa. Hello? They don't care how they dress in their religion. I mean, them Muslims will run up and down the streets in their dresses. Priests and nuns will run up and down the street in their dresses. They ain't worried about what somebody thinks about their religion. But somehow, for us to live clean and holy and modest, somehow in our Christianity today, that's a sin. When did conservative holy dressing ever become a sin? It's hated. Amen? Let's look at Romans chapter 1. We'll end up there. Romans chapter number 1. I don't want to fit in with God's enemies. I want people to hate me. Hello? I don't want to be an offense to the gospel, but I don't want to be ashamed of it. Amen. Right? You know what they are in Romans 1:30? They're haters of God. Haters of God. You know what Titus chapter 1 or chapter 3 says? 1 to 3. Before I was saved, I was hateful and I was hating. Now I hate sin. I hate the devil. I hate wickedness. I hate unrighteousness. I hate lying. I hate pride. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride, arrogancy, the froward mouth, perversion. You know, people come in, they'll tell you a dirty joke. Hello? I don't think there's nothing good about it. Hello? Most jokes are all sensual, sexual in orientation, men laughing and joking about adultery and fornication, things like that. I don't see nothing pleasant about it. Hello? Amen. Listen, preaching, you know what it does? It brings hope. It brings help. It brings health. It brings people's hearts. I mean, it deals with it. It brings happiness. But it also hurts the flesh, the world, the devil. It harms. Amen. The work, the devil's work brings heaven to men and reveals light about hell. Old time preaching will produce holiness and it's hated by the world. Amen. That's why people don't want to preach. That's why old time preachers don't want to preach. Right. That's why they don't want me to come preach at their fellowships. Mm. I can go preach. I can go to these Baptist fellowships. I'd be a good old boy, preach a little something out of Matthew chapter number 5. I wonder how many of them preachers peel each other's onions. We're supposed to have fellowship today. We gather here to eat dinner. Who are you to come preach against our sins? Maybe somebody ought to go preach against the preacher's sins. Maybe somebody ought to go preach to preachers about their stinking unbelief and correcting the Bible. Hello? Maybe we ought to have somebody get up and preach to preachers about their compromise. Not willing to draw the sword when it needs drawn. Not willing to cut when they need to cut. Willing to compromise for a paycheck. Yep. You know what Elijah told Ahab? He said, you sold yourself to do evil. But wouldn't that be a fun sermon to preach at a preacher's fellowship? Huh? Not for sale. Not for sale! It means I'm not going to hire out as a hireling and be tangled around like a puppet and be a politician for a bunch of people when God called me to preach. Amen. You know what that is? He said, be not dismayed at their faces. He told Ezekiel, whether they hear, whether they forbear, they're most rebellious. He said, I'm going to give you an iron forehead. You know what we are? We're sheep. You know what they do? They ram. He said, I'm going to give you an iron forehead. He said, you're going to be a king headbutter, boy. And when you butt heads, amen, it ain't going to dent your head because you got an iron forehead. He said, I want you to go out there and butt heads. We don't want no headbutt preacher, you know, butt. He's a goat. No, that's what rams do. They butt heads. You know what deer do? They lock horns. Amen. They all challenge the big buck in the crowd. Amen. You better have an iron forehead. You'll be a preacher, you better have an iron forehead. Hello? I'm not talking about not having compassion. You know, and compassionate will tell the truth and stand up and do right. But somehow they think preacher ought to be a weenie. You know what they do? They put them on the grill and they roast them. Mm-hmm. Hello. Listen, I'm talking about old time preaching. I'm talking about helping people. Giving them hope. Giving them health. Touching their hearts. Bringing happiness. But boy, I'm telling you what, there's people that hate God. They hate righteousness. Hate holiness. We must stand. Isn't there one more preacher around here that we can hear from? Isn't there another prophet besides these 400 that's telling us to go up and prosper? Isn't there one? Yeah. Ahab said, there's one. His name's Micaiah. He said, but I hate him because he never prophesied nothing good concerning me. See, there's what it is. He hates them. Why? Because he tells the truth. Brother Nick, you dismiss us, please.
Suppose at night when you close your eyes, you take your final breath. All the years you spent here on earth, not a minute would you have left. Did you ever ask the Lord to save you? Ever get down on your knees and pray? Do you know what you're gonna hear when you face Him on Judgment Day? Will He say, enter in, my good and faithful one? Or will He say, depart from me, I never knew you and the wicked things you've done? Will you enter heaven's gates or hell? Fire down below. Close your eyes for the final time.